So yesterday we had a discussion upon the Nexus 9500 series. Of course, today we'll be discussing the Nexus 9300 series. So what was the difference between 9500 and 9300? Anyone in the chat? Abdul, Sushant sir.
The fixed and modular.
Yeah, wonderful. So your Nexus 9500 were the modular switches, right? And Nexus 9300 are the fixed switches. Okay. Now, in your Nexus 9300, see, not all the devices are supporting, not all the series of your Nexus 9000 are supporting the ACI, but some of the devices are supporting the ACI spine and the leaf architecture. So we're going to be discussing it today. Okay. Now, Nexus 9300, as I told, are the fixed switches. In these fixed switches, that means all your control plane, all your management plane, as well as your data plane are being integrated in one single device. You cannot remove anything and you cannot insert anything. One thing. Now in this, there are multiple ranges, or I'll define as multiple variants, which are available in the same, like one variant is 9336 PQ. Now, what is this PQ? I'll explain you. Then you have 9372 PX. After that, you have 9396 TX. You have 9396 PX. These are the different models you have. After that, you have 93128 TX and 93128 PX. Furthermore, you have 9364C. Okay, and you have 9332. So we'll be discussing all these particular models. A lot of variants are there. Some of them we're going to discuss it over here, which are the main ones. Okay. Now, first of all, what is P? P stands for all your SFP port. Understand. Very easy. P stands for all your SFP port. Small pluggable form factor. Okay. T stands for, that means your port are RJ45 ports. RJ45 ports. When this T get appended with the X, TX, that means those RJ45 ports are of 10 gig. Okay. And the same goes for the PX. That means your SFP port of 10 gig. Remember, I told you there will be multiple SFP transmitters, which you're going to see, okay, multiple SFP modules and the models, which you're going to see, which will be 1 gig, which will be 8 gig for the fiber. So there are two types of SFP modules. One goes for the fiber channel. One goes for your, So one goes for the fiber channel and another one goes for your Ethernet based. Okay. So for both the technologies, you have multiple devices. Okay. You'll get to know. This is completely based upon how much you're going to research on those devices. Like today, I'll be taking your Nexus 2000 also. Okay. Now 2000 somehow are being called as FEX, Fabric Extender. I'll tell you in the detail what this is. But over there, the normal SFP module, if you want to insert, that will not work. Okay. I'll show you the models also. There are different serial numbers which are being written, but those model number will not be applicable on FEX or in certain 5K devices. Those particular models will not be applicable. You have to check that does your FEX support that particular model or not. Variation is there. In FEX, a normal 10G will not work. There is a transmitter or the SFP module called as FET. Okay, that works inside that. Okay, yeah, it's very old, pretty old, sir. Okay, but still getting used in the market, still getting used in CCIE lab. Okay, now, then after that, you have one more model called as PQ. PQ stand for, basically, this is for quad SFP. Quad SFP, yesterday also I told you it's 40 gig. Okay. I hope, Rickwood, you have gone through the previous lecture in the afternoon. Okay. Now, So you have PQ, have quad SFP, 40 gig ports are there.
Yes, I did. I went through that this morning.
Wonderful, wonderful. Then things will be pretty clean. Okay. Then when you see this alphabet, like somewhere you'll see U, you are basically, sorry, not U, with respect to the X, PX, TX, these are all 10G, whether in Ethernet, whether in your SFP modules. Okay. Now, let us discuss and let us see that what are the things we had in these models. Just a second. Okay, so this is your Nexus 9300 platform architecture. These are the two rack unit height of the switches. As you can see now how the switch looks. Apart from that, it supports almost 2.8 Tbps of bandwidth. Now, how to calculate these particular things, that also I'll tell you. 36 fixed port, 40 QSFP plus port. Okay, what you are seeing over here, these are all QSFP ports, quad SFP. Okay. Apart from that, there is a management port. There is a console port, which you can take for the console in order to manage the login into that particular device. And then you have the USB port as well in order for the file transfer. Okay. So this is being considered maximum time. You'll see that this particular model is considered as a spine switch. Spine switch. Why? Because it has the capability to transmit a 40 gig of traffic from a single port. 40 gig of traffic from a single port. So that is why it is being recommended, or it is being taken as a spine switch. Okay, front to back, you'll be having the airflow options. Redundant power supply units will be there, and fan units will be there as well. So pretty simple. These are your spine switches. Okay, nothing more in that. After that, your 9336, 9332 PQ. Okay. Then you have PQ. Again, PQ stand for your quad SFP. This is a single rack unit device, as you can see. The last one which you had was a double rack unit. This is a single rack unit, one RU. Okay. Almost 2.56 Tbps of bandwidth it's going to support. Okay. As you can see, there are 32 quad SFP ports. 32 quad SFP ports which are being given. One single management port, one console port, two USB port. So these are just the differences which you're going to see inside the chassis. Okay. Now, in this, if you are able to see this yellow line, right, there is an indication for that. What is this yellow line? Yeah, this yellow strip, I will say. It's a strip. Okay. Yellow strips always implies that these are your uplink port. Uplink port. Now, these can be a 40 gig port as well. These can be a 100 gig port as well. Okay. Uplink port in order to connect all multiple devices. So over here, what you'll have uplink port, you'll get a chance to use your breakout cable, which we discussed yesterday, which we have discussed yesterday, your breakout cable. 140 gig port, and then there are four splitters of 10 gig each. Right? This is what we have seen yesterday. So now have a look over here. You have one particular port of 40 gig. You have total 32 ports. Apart from that, there are six ports, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. These six ports, if you connect the breakout cable, you'll be able to connect four devices from each port, total made up of 24. Okay. So I'll say 4 into 6, you'll have 24 ports. Total apart from that, you have the 32 ports of 40 GB. That makes it how much? Okay, this can be in further more devices, you'll be seeing the port differences. So 24, these apart from that, 32, you have more. Okay, 32 plus 24, 40. Oh no, not the 8 ports. Sir, if you divide this as a breakout cable in order to connect multiple devices, right? In that particular manner, I'm telling you. Yeah. Okay, so you can do the math on that. Now, next, in that you'll get a more clarity about this particular mathematics, that how it's being taken care of. Now you have the 9372. Okay, have a look over here. Again, the yellow strips. Now have a look. If you have noticed, now this kind of device is considered sometimes as a leaf switch also. And all the ports are SFP, normal 10 gig ports. These are your 10 gig ports, SFP modules, small ones. Apart from that, there are 6 quad SFP. Yellow strip means that these are the uplink ports. These can be 40 gig, these can be 100 gigs. Okay. Now, total number of 6. If I use a breakout cable for one port having 4 different connections, total number of devices can be attached, 6 into 4, 24. Another thing, 48. These are 48 ports of 10G. 48 ports of 20G. 48, 58, 68, and 72. Okay. And this is how this particular model becomes 9372PX. I hope now it is clear. Why this 72 is being mentioned? 9300 series we are talking about. So that is your 93. The first two digits representing the series. The last two digits representing what are the number of 10 gig ports over here. Okay, X stand for your 10 gig ports. SFP module stand for the P. You have 9372 because this comes with a total of 72 ports like that of 10 gig. As per the configuration, there are certain commands which you need to execute. Okay, it's not like that if you use a breakout cable and you plug it in directly over here and you connect 4 different devices, it will automatically get configured. No, there are certain commands which are required that we'll see in the later section whenever we're going to do the practicals of these particular things. Okay, you have to insert certain command in order to split that 40 gig cable into 10 gig each. Okay, it will not automatically break. Now, continuing ahead, then you have 9396 model. Now have a look again. Let's do the math. We'll get a clear idea that why these devices are being named in such a way. Okay, again, 9300 belongs to the series. 93, last two belongs to the port. How many, how much, how? 48 1GB SFP or 10GBPS SFP plus ports are present. Okay, so I'll write at 48. Those are the 10G ports which you already have as been stated over here. These are your 48 ports. This is your complete line card over here. Apart from that, if you want to see, there are 1240 GBPS port, quad SFP port. Okay, 12 into 4. Why? With one port, you can connect 4 different 10 gig devices after splitting. 12 into 4, 48. 48 plus 48, you get the value 96. And that's how it becomes the 96PX. This is how you actually look for the data center devices, that what are the capabilities and how much maximum number of ports we can utilize on top of that. So this, what you are seeing, this is what? Anyone? This is a expansion module, guys. This is called as expansion module. Okay. Abdul sir, total SFP ports, which are of 10 gig. How many ports we have? 48. It's being written over here. Correct, sir? Okay. Just you can type yes or no. So 48 total ports. And after that, I have quad SFP port. How much? How many? 12, right? If I distribute using a breakout cable, each of the port, so each port will get splitted into 4 10 gig ports. Furthermore, I can attach multiple switches of 10 gig, right? Using a breakout cable. So if I use 12 into 4, it will become 48. 48 plus 48, you're gonna get the answer 96. This is how it has become 96 port. Clear, sir? Great. Now, so, and this is called as your expansion module. Now, understand, I have told you clearly that your 9300 series are the fixed switches. But this expansion module doesn't come inside that particular category of being called as a fixed switch or a like a modular switch. In modular, every part, like your control plane, your management plane, as well as your data plane, can be inserted or can be removed, including the fan trays, including the line cards, including the fabric modules, okay, including your system controller, and multiple things, your cooling trays and the fan trays and other things. Everything can be removed and inserted, your supervisor modules as well. Very important. Interesting. But in this, you do have one expansion module which will be used to expand the capabilities of that particular switch. But, you have to make a separate purchase order for that. Okay. Expansion module on top, you need to make a purchase order for that. Okay. And in this, you might get a 10G variant, or you also might receive a 40G variant, that are different models within the same. For 10 gig also, it's available for 40 gig. If you want to insert these port as 10 gig only, you can do that. If you want a 40 gig expansion module, you can get that 40 gig also. Having a 40 gig module, obviously price will be increased, capex will be increased, but there will be much more feasibility you will get in the long run using the breakout cables. You can connect multiple aggregation layer devices inside that. Okay, it is still a fixed switch. It is not a modular switch. Make sure of that. Then you have 93120. Now same mathematics goes over here. How many total ports are there? We have the 96 ports. 96 10G ports. How many are these? 6. Okay, 640 gig into 4 equals to 24. 24 plus 96. You can do the math now, I hope. 0, 1, 10, 12. 120 ports. And that's how it become 9300 series and total 120. And these all ports are Ethernet. That's the reason this code TX is being written. If written PX, SFP port, SFP plus modules, written TX, your Ethernet based transmitters. So these all 96 ports are Ethernet, and this is your quad SFP ports. Okay. Now, same way, the last in this, the same last model of the series, you have the 93128 as well. See, 96 Ethernet ports. Apart from that, 840 gig ports. Now, in this, just to clear your head, don't go as per the PIC. Okay. In PIC, it is being shown as total 12, if you want to notice. These are 12 ports. It's being completely written, even in the documentation and even in the math, states that total 840 Gbps ports are there, and these are your 96 port. Okay, 3 RU device, much more heavier as compared to others. Total 8 ports, 8 into 4, you have the answer as 32. Total 96, 96 plus 32, you got the 8 and you get, 12. And this is how it becomes 128 TX, stand for Ethernet, 9300 series. And this is a way of actually checking how you're gonna buy that particular device. Rest everything, you're gonna see that it's completely same, I would say. Okay. Now, let's talk about your next series of switches. So 9500 and 9300 are clear with respect to your modular switches and your 9300 series as the fixed switches. Inside that, some switches will be available with respect to what? Your spine and the leaf architecture, two-tier. So mainly what is being said, so just one second. So mainly what it's being told, that your 9500, like somewhere, when you're going to see the Cisco documentation or somewhere, you're going to see a PIC in which you'll be able to see like an architecture is being created So these are your spine switches and these are your leaf switches. Let's suppose. Okay, this is called your two-tier architecture in your ACI, also called as your PLOS architecture, in which every spine is being connected. This is a kind of a mesh topology. Every spine is being connected to every leaf. So in that, it's being told that best recommended 9500 series goes for the spine switches. Sorry, spine are never directly connected. Sir, spine are, it is getting directly connected. Spine to spine connectivity doesn't happen. Okay, spine is never getting connected directly to other spine. Yeah, so where it is getting connected? These are your leaf switches. Sorry, I should be writing the L over here. My bad. Now it's fine, sir. Okay, your spine does get connected to the leaf switches directly, but your spine doesn't get connected to the spine. But in that, now, anyone heard this particular terminology called as multipod or multi-site? Okay, anyone heard this? Abdul sir, Sushant sir?
So multi-site is between two data centers, and multi-site
yes.
is within the.
Correct, sir. So now, if I draw the diagram, I'll not be explaining anything as of now. I'll not be going into the detail. I just want to create interest. See, this is a rule. Your spine will never get connected to other spine. This will never happen. Okay, this is never going to happen. Spine automatically detect all the leaf which it is getting connected to. All the leaf and the spine, these devices will be getting discovered by a single controller called as APIC. That discovery, I'll tell you. What are the issues that gonna come in that discovery? That also I'll tell you. What a minor issue can disrupt your whole discovery? That also I'll tell you. Okay. That will be a complete explanation on that at the time of ACI. Everything it will be going into the detail. But as of now, understand. Okay. I have the spine switches, guys. And I have the leaf. I have the spine switches. I have the leaf. This is your multi-site. This is your DC1. This is your DC2. Somewhere over here, what will be there? There will be a layer 3 device. Basically, a layer 3 switch or something. An I-pin. Interpod connectivity. Or in the multi-site, there will be a different scenario. But understand, now this spine somehow is getting connected to another spine. If you see the logical topology as of now. But over here, I just said the spine will never get connected to the spine. Even if there is a switch in between, spine doesn't get connected to another spine. Remember that. But over here, the things are different. That's we're going to be understanding furthermore in your ACI chapters. Not as of now. So we'll be sticking out now again to your devices. Some of the 9300 devices, just now coming back. In the 9300, I told that these are best recommended for the leaf switches, and 9500 are best recommended to be used at the spine switches, as spines are more heavy and these are the one which will be used in order to transmit the data of high bandwidth. But again, one more thing. Somewhere in some documentation of Cisco only, there are certain 9300 series switches like your 9336PQ. Whenever you're going to search 9336PQ, it will say that it's a spine switch. It's going to say that. Definitely. Cisco 9336PQ. Okay. See, ACI spine switch. The first search itself gives you Cisco Nexus 9336PQ ACI spine switch. So certain models inside the 9300 series still can be used as the spine switches, having the higher bandwidth capacity. Okay. No problem, Sujan sir. See you. Okay. Now, the next series which we're going to be talking about is Cisco 7000 series. Okay. These are also being considered somewhere at the core layer switches. Okay. These are completely NXOS based switches. Okay. The main difference, yesterday also I told you the main difference between the 9000 versus the 7000, 9K versus 7K. Both are the core layer, but 7K only comes with a NXOS. 9K, certain models comes with both NXOS mode as well as the ACI mode. That we already discussed yesterday about. Now in your Nexus 7000, there are only two series. Okay. One is your 7000 and another one is 7700. In 7000 model series, you have four variant. That is your 7004, then you have your 7009, then you have your 7010, and then you have your 7018. For 7700 series, you have four different variants. Those are your 7702, then you have 7706, you have 7710, and you have 7718. These are the four different models in each of the series you have. These are the only two series, 7000 and 7700. Again, as you can see, the first two denotes the device ID. The device series belongs to Nexus 7K. Last two digits denote the total number of slots present into the device in which you can insert both line cards as well as the supervisor module. Okay. The last two digits represent the slot in which you can insert both your line cards plus your soup module. Soup module taking care of your control plane and the management plane, right? Yesterday we discussed. Line cards are nothing but those ports, those interfaces. So based upon the model, these are the total number of slots, like 7004. So there are total four slots in which you can insert the line cards and the soup module. So for 7004, there are two slots available for line cards plus two slots available for your supervisor module. For 7009, there are seven slots available for line card plus there are two soup module. For 7010, eight line cards plus two soup module. For 7018 model, there are 16 line cards. Huge, very huge, interesting. Plus there are two supervisor module. Now, understand. Sir, the line cards and the supervisor module, right? Obviously, these will be having a different physical form factor. Right, Abdul sir? Make sense? Line card will be having a different size, a different length and width. Supervisor module will be a little different. So the port, the slot under which you're gonna insert your line card are fixed. The slot under you gonna insert your supervisor module will be fixed as well. Fixed means that if slot number 1 and 2 are being reserved for supervisor module, that are the ones in which you're gonna enter the soup module. In other slot, you cannot insert the soup module. It's not gonna detect it. It's not gonna get inserted. So actually, what I mean to write over here is that slot number 1 and slot number 2 are basically reserved for the soup module. Similarly, slot number 1 and 2 reserved over here with respect to 7009 as well. For 7010, slot number 5 and 6 are reserved. Okay. Well, I'll show you as well. And slot 7018, 9 and 10 number slot is reserved for your soup module. Now, let's have a look over here. Nexus 7018. Nexus 7010. Nexus 7004. Why am I writing 2004? 7018. Have a look. This is your pick. Let's go to the images. 7010 chassis. Okay, I don't know. 18 chassis. The picture is not coming much clearer. Okay, now see, have a look. There are total number of 18 slots present. This is your Nexus 7018 model. Okay, this is your Nexus 7018 model. This is a pick of that. Now, if I increase this photo, and you can see over here, slot number 1, 2, the numbers are being given. I'm not sure whether you are able to see 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and then slot number 9 and slot number 10. These are being reserved with respect to the supervisor module. These are your soup module. I'm talking about with respect to 7018. So two soup modules, and there are 16 line cards in total. Total 8 over here, 8 gonna be over here. Okay. From 11 to 18 present, from 1 to 7, 8, sorry, 8 present over here. And two supervisor module. That is how the slots are being segregated. Below given are these are the power supply units. Okay. There will be power supply units, heat dissipation, there will be fan trays, of course. So 7018, sir, exact size, I'm not sure about how many rack unit it is, but if you still understand, this is one RU. Every kind of line card is one RU, right? And even you're gonna insert the basically supervisor module, and over here, have a look. These supervisor module now are full width. In yesterday's lecture, what we had with respect to the 9500 series were the half width supervisor module. Present side by side. These are full width. That means 1 RU, the space it's gonna take as well. And line cards are generally of 1 RU if I am not wrong. So total, how many rack unit it's gonna take now? Have a look, sir. Full cabinet. Yeah, it's a full cabinet because there are 18 slots total. So I'll say 18 RU is being required. Apart from that, below you have still the basically cooling system and the power supply intake, which is being present over here. So yeah, it's gonna consume a huge one. It's like a small cabinet you're gonna have, and pretty much heavy. I'm thinking how to load it up. Apart from that, see, these are what? So these are all your heat dissipation. Okay. These are your handles. Like to pick up that 7000 device. Okay. These handles will be both sides. Handle number 1, 2 and 2 over there. So this is your complete chassis. If you're gonna see over here, let me reset it. This is your complete series. This is your complete series of all the devices. Have a look. Your 7004, 7009, 7010, then 18, 7718, 7710, and 776. Okay, we have not talked about right now with this. We'll be talking now after 5 minutes. But these are the model 4, 9, 10, and 18. In which there are two supervisor module as well as the other will be distributed among the line cards. Okay. Now, in 9500 series, there were all line cards representing the last two digits. Remember that. When we are talking about the 9Ks, the last two digit were representing the number of line card. In your 7K series, the last two digits are recommending the slot in which you want to insert basically what? Your soup module as well as your line cards. Total number of slots. Okay. So that difference should be clear. Coming back over here. Now, there is one more model, I'll say. Okay. Similarly, with respect to your 7700 series, like your 7706, your 77010, or 7710, and 7718. So 9 and 10 slot is reserved for your supervisor module. Same goes for this, 5 and 6 for supervisor module, and slot number 3 and 4 for supervisor module. But there is one more model, which is 7702. In this, only one soup module and only one line card is there. I told you that supervisor module, as a best practice, should always be in a redundancy factor, right? In an active standby mode. They are always best recommended. Two should be there for the redundancy purposes. But over here, you have one soup module and you have one line card for 7702, which basically these are like low grade. You can do the practice for, okay, very low switches. These are in which you can, like, if you are building up a new data center, you can go ahead and start with these kind of devices. Just like that, nothing else. Okay. Now, these are the modular devices. So you have the different modules in that. 7K, as you can see, you are able to insert line cards. As per the different modules, you have the capacity to increase or decrease the number of line cards. And when I say that I can remove or insert any particular physical module, that means it's a modular switch. So your 7K are the modular switches, in which there can be multiple modules can be inserted or removed, like your supervisor, line card, fabric module, fan rack unit, and power supply. Remember, which particular module is not being contained within 7Ks and that we have inside 9K? Which particular module was that? Abdul sir, do you remember? Yesterday we talked about. There was one module which was not present in 7K, but it came around after in 9K. Cisco made a change. Which one was that? Any idea? Yes, no. So that was being called as your system controller. That was being called as system controller. Okay. So earlier in 7Ks, your soup module was handling all the control plane and the management plane. But this soup module was also responsible in order to monitor the fan rack units, the power supply, okay, the monitoring of how much capacity or heat is getting generated. Based on that, different indications it's going to generate. So these kind of things were also getting responsible to take care of by your supervisor module. So in order to ease the work of the supervisor module, in 9K, Cisco decided that I'll segregate it. I'll segregate and only control plane and management plane work will be done by your supervisor module. For fan trays, monitoring, diagnostic, for these kind of things, I'll create one more module called a system controller. So there is no system controller in 7K, only for 9K it is present. Okay, and I hope it's clear. Now, talking about the models of the supervisor module, soup module in your 7K series. So in 7000, you have basically soup 1. These are the models, very old. I'll say soup 1, end of life, end of sale. Apart from that, you had the soup 2, you had the soup 2E. So these are the different modules which are available. And in 7700, you have the soup 2E and soup 3E. These are the different models of the line cards. Oh, sorry, supervisor module. And you have to check whatever device you have. As per that, you can go with the modules. Talking about the line cards, what are the different line cards you have? The availability of the line cards in 7K series. You have the F series line card over here, and you have the M series line cards. In F, three models, F1, F2, F3. F1, F2, F2E. These are the three different models. And over here in M series, you have the M1, you have the M2, you have the M2E, you have the M3. So based upon the device, there are different variants which are being given. F series basically gives you the layer 2 capabilities. Basically, I'm telling you, okay? F series is very good in giving the layer 2 capabilities or functionalities like all your layer 2 protocols. Okay, and also it's gonna give you the advanced layer 2 protocols also, like your RSTP, okay, like your root guard, BPDO filter, and this and that. But F series will contain a very basic amount of L3 functionalities. Very basic. I'll not say the complete advanced one, but very basic. Okay. Whereas your M series will contain the basic L2 capabilities and more advanced L3 capabilities. Like your routing protocols, different routing protocols, whatever you talk about, BGP, you talk about your OSPF and other routing protocols and other layer 3 capabilities. It's gonna be at the advanced level in the M series. And a very basic of L2 capabilities will be carried out in your M series models of the line cards. Oh, yes. Okay. Now, talking about next, the availability of the fabric modules inside that. Okay. So one model is called as Fab1, Fabric Module 1, Fab1. This is the name of the model with respect to Nexus 7000 series. Bandwidth, total support, 46 Gbps per slot of throughput. Per complete slot of throughput, if you have 46 Gbps, okay, so if I talk about Nexus 7000 Fab1, Fabric Module 1. So this is how your Fabric Module does looks like. Okay, for a 10 slot chassis, 46 Gbps per slot is being offered. Maximum, how many fabric module you can insert inside your 7000 series. So for 7000 series, a maximum of 5 fabric modules you can insert, whereas for 7700 series, a maximum of 6 fabric modules you can insert. And now, as I told, what was the role of the fabric module? In order to have the complete bandwidth. Okay, fabric module was being used to have the bandwidth, the complete throughput, which it gonna carry out. So in your 7000 series, a maximum of 5 say, fabric modules, which you can insert, and 77 maximum of 6 fabric modules. Each slot having the 46 Gbps, if I multiply with the 5, the total bandwidth you wanna have will be total 230 Gbps. With respect to your 7010 also, 7018 also. Okay, for these two models. Then another model is there called as your Fab2. Fabric Module 1, Fabric Module 2. 110 Gbps, guys, per slot for 7000 series. Total 510 into 5. How many? 550 Gbps of the bandwidth you're gonna get in total, guys. Applicable for all 7009 series, 7010 series, and 7018 model. Okay. For your 7700, you do have the Fab2 available. For 7000 and 77, both, okay, for 7000, both Fab1 and Fab2, but for 7700, you do have the Fab2, which is being available. In model, 7706, 7710, and 7718. Okay. So, for 7000, you have both 1 and 2, Fab1 and 2. For 7700, you do have Fab2 only. And yeah, that is what we required, right? 110 Gbps slot, total of 6. If you have 2 fabric modules, total 220 Gbps. If you have 6 fabric modules in total, okay, for the Fab2, 110 Gbps, which is being available. See, sorry, my bad, guys. This particular value is being available as per when you're going to insert it into your 7000 series. Okay. Not applicable for 7700. My bad. For the 7706, 7710, and 7718. Now, one fabric module which you are using over there is having the capacity of 220 Gbps. The Fab2 which you'll be running. Fab2, 220 per slot. Total capacity of Fab2 over here, I have written 6 fabric modules you can insert into 6. You have the capacity of almost 1.3 Tbps, I think. Total 1.3 Tbps terabytes of the bandwidth you're gonna have. Okay. Having the 2 supervisor module will generate what? The redundancy and the high availability for the control plane and the management plane. The 4 slot chassis, the model which we have talked about, the 4 slot chassis, which was your 7004, right? In that, it doesn't contain or it doesn't require any kind of fabric modules. The local input output module are connected at the back only, and those who gonna do the work. The number of input output modules which you have as per the 7004 model, 7004 slot chassis, there is no dedicated fabric module which comes. That's the reason I have written over here, if you see, 9, 10, and 18. I have not talked about 7004 over here. No, because there is no fabric module which you can insert. The basic input output module which it gonna come with from the back, that are the one who gonna determine everything. Okay, the total bandwidth, the total throughput. But fabric redundancy is still being provided with respect to the input output module. But if this got failed, if this IO input output module got failed, your complete chassis will go down. Okay. All the modules, including the power trays, including the fan, including the power supply, are accessible from the front. Only these input output modules are being there at the rear end. Everything else will be on the front end. Okay. Then after that, there is a Fab3 also. Okay. Which only supports certain models. Those are 7706, 7710. With in total 6 insertions of the modules, in total up to, I'll say, with each module having the bandwidth of 464 Gbps. The last in Fab2, which we discussed, what, 220. Now see, have a look, it's 464 Gbps, guys. Total bandwidth up to 2.64. How are you going to make it? 464 into 6, simple as that. No rocket science. Total 6 modules you can give it, each having 464 into 6. This is the total TBPS bandwidth, what you can consume or send the data as per that. Okay, clear till now, everyone? Abdul, Sushant, record.
Yeah, clear.
What about you, Abdul? Are you there? Okay. So, wonderful, sir, wonderful. Okay. Now, the next series, 5,000. Okay. Again, 6 switches, 5Ks. These are all fixed switches. Running on which operating system? NXOS. On which layer these are running? On the distribution layer. These are not the core layer switches, guys. These are the distribution layer. I'll show you as well. Only two series models are there. 5500, 5600 series. Only two models are there in 5500, 5548 and 5596. Only two models are there in 5600, that is 5672 UP, and there is 56128. Now over here, you're going to be learning certain more things. Okay, these are not as same as your 9Ks and your 7Ks. There are certain more capabilities which you will get in 5Ks, of course, and that's make it different from the core layer switches. Okay, you'll deal with it mainly in the at the time, or if further ahead you might be interested in learning about the storage, the UCS, and that you'll understand the basically the feature and the functionalities of the 5Ks that we'll be discussing over here as well. Okay, now the first two digits, obviously the series number 55 and 56, right? The last two are the total number of ports in both the scenarios. Okay. Now in this 96, you will get the TX also. Okay. Somewhere you will get the PX also. PX, TX. So basically these can be Ethernet and these can be the SFP modules as well. Okay. In 5672 UP. Now this UP, what is this UP? I'll tell you. Okay, UP stands for unified ports. Okay, by default, in your Nexus 5K series, the port which comes are the unified ports. That means these are all the Ethernet ports. But what is the meaning of unified? That you can run, you can also run the fiber channel onto these port. These are all Ethernet port, but you can use it in order to pass the fiber channel traffic. Generally, when we talk about with respect to the storage. Okay. So there are two models in your 55596 over here. Let me change the ink. In this, you're going to get 5596 UP also. In this, you will now have 5596T also. T stand for normal Ethernet port. But if you're going to go to UP, you will be getting the unified port. That means you can use those 96 port over here as an Ethernet or as a fiber channel, both. Interesting. And it does make a difference. Okay. I'll tell you how it is being segregated among the chassis. How it is being completely segregated upon the chassis and how you're going to have a look. So there are multiple color code which are present. For example, in your 5500 series, okay, there are different color codes which you want to see. And that same color code is being somewhere defined in your 9Ks also. Like there will be a yellow strip, orange strip, which will be present. Okay. Yellow, basically these are your all uplink port. Can be of 40 gig, can be of 100 gig interfaces. Orange stand for the unified ports, which will define either it can be Ethernet based or FC based. You can decide, you can change a one single port from ETH to FC capable. You can change a series of port. And when I'm saying the change, it's not gonna be a physical change. It's just gonna be a configurational change which you have to do for that particular port, and it's gonna convert into complete FC. And that denotion can be done by looking at either the green or the purple color you will see inside basically the GUIs or the other scenario, that it is being converted as a pure FC, pure fiber channel. Okay, and by that, let me show you over here. 5672 UP. There is the model. Here are the images. And here you go, guys. Okay, have a look. You see this orange strip, and then you have the yellow strips. So orange strip denotes that these can be converted. These are all unified ports. Okay, so the normal range which you are able to see, okay, segment number one, these are all your, either it can be SFP port or either it can be a Ethernet module. Okay, rest, these one, so these are all your FC ports. First of all, let me tell you, for this particular device, these are all your FC base port. Okay, after that, rest, these are unified. So the range comes over here in 5672 UP is from 33 to 48. These are the total 32 ports, which comes by default via the Ethernet. Next are the unified ports. So I just have to log in into the device, and I just have to hit the command, okay, that interface range ETH from 33 to 48. I just have to give it whatever the 1/something is there. And after that, inside your configurational mode, I'll give the command port type FC. And then it's gonna convert the port type into your FC. And after that, in order to bring the change, you have to hit the command called as reload. A complete switch will go into the reload. And then after that, port number 33 to 48 will be capable enough to have the traffic for the fiber channel. Okay, a complete series. Then your, if you're gonna do the command like show interface brief, right, you will be able to see in show interface brief, you'll be able to see that there are certain devices which will be called as your FC. There will be certain devices called as ETH. Okay, if you want to see a little, I'll say a practical explanation on this. So just give me a second. Let me show you. Okay. So here you go. So I'll just do what? Hit the putty. There is one. I don't know if it is turned on or not. This is a physical device. I think the device is shut down. The device is shut down. The device is not available. Or maybe someone from the office has turned it off. Otherwise, I would have shown you. I'll show you in the next lecture, not a problem. So basically, you'll see that there is a range from starting from 1 to 32. You'll be seeing that, okay, these are Ethernet ports. Before that, there will be a complete range of segment which will show that from 33 to 48, these are port type FC. Okay, fiber channel completely. So that is also one thing which is good about your 5K models. Then there is also something called as a daughter card. Okay, so first of all, let me show you that what actually is a daughter card, and then I'll tell you what it is being used for. Daughter card, Cisco Nexus. Okay, images. So these are your daughter cards. The small cards which you're gonna see over here, these are called as your daughter cards. So whenever you buy a 5500 series model device or 5600 series, by default, these devices are the layer 2 device. Okay, these are the layer 2 device. But what if you want to make the device capable of layer 3 also? What if you want to make the device as layer 3 also? For example, have a look. Layer 3 on Nexus 5548P. For that, Cisco does give option of having a layer 3 based daughter card. At that time, you need to insert a daughter card also. So daughter card will provide the layer 3 forwarding capabilities. And it is completely upgradable. Nothing of the unmounting is being required. You can just insert it and that will give you a layer 3 capability to that particular 5500 series switch that can come into 5500, that will come into 5600 also. Even 5672 UP comes with a daughter card. Okay, which you can have it further more ahead. As you can see over here also certain picks. So these all which are being completely removed from the chassis, these are your daughter cards, which gives you the layer 3 forwarding capabilities. Okay, now coming back. Over here, if I talk. So this is your 5672 UP. Okay. How many total ports? It is saying 48 fixed ports. 48 fixed ports. Now, if you want to see at the right side, what do you have? These are the 6 yellow strip. When I say a yellow strip, what it denotes? The uplink port, correct? Now, these uplink port can be furthermore, can get connected to what? Different series of the switches. What are these port? Quad SFP. How many port? Total number of 6, 40 each, okay, will be divided of 10 gig, 4, 24, over here we got. Apart from that, these are 48 fixed port from 1 to 32, then 33 to 48, you have the unified ports over here. All 10 gig ports support up to 10 gig, obviously, 1 gig also will support. Up to 10 gig support is there. So you can have the Ethernet as well as the FCO in that. That means now you can insert in this slot an SFP module, which can be of 10G capable. Obviously, when I say the series 10G, what is the Ethernet series? 1, 10, 100, 1000, right? This is how it works. 10,000. How the fiber, this is your ETH, how the fiber channel series works, 2, okay, then you have 8, you have 16, this is how it works. So in this Ethernet based, you can have the 10G capable transmitter or the SFP plus modules, whereas once you convert these port, by default, it will be Ethernet only, okay, when you're gonna buy the switch. You have to make a configuration. After that, you can convert it into FC. After FC, these port will be able to detect the fiber channel base SFP module. Means 8 gig. Speed of 8G. Okay. This is how you can convert. This is what is mean by unified port. 2 Gbps, 4 Gbps, 8 Gbps, as well as you have Ethernet, 10 Gbps. So generally, these particular ports are being required in order to get connectivity towards the storage devices. Okay, FCOE. FC storage device. Okay. 5672. 56 is the series. 72 are the total number of ports. How many? These are the 48 fixed port. Apart from that, you have 24. 48 plus 24. How many it got? 72. That's how it becomes 72. UP stand for unified. Okay. Similarly, you have 56128P. See, 2RU, multiple RU switches, 2RU switch, not a single one. 48 fixed 1 or 10 gig SFP plus port. Okay. Then on top, there are multiple 2 expansion slots which are being given. Capacity has been increases. It got increased from 72 to 128 ports in total. This is fixed. These are the 2 expansion slot. By default, if you're going to buy this switch, these will be just locked out. Okay. You'll see a complete plate which is being covered on top of that. If you further want to increase, you can increase by purchasing the expansion slots. Each and every expansion slot comes with 2 uplink port. So total 2 over here, 2 over here, and you have the 4 uplink port over here, 4 into 4. You have 16. Okay, 2 into 4, you got the 8. Over here, you got the 8. Each, if I segregate as a breakout cable with respect to 10 gig, 16 plus 8. How much? 24 plus 8, 32. 32 plus how many? 48 ports over here. 10 gig. Okay. That is saying what? 48 fixed 10 gig or 1 gig port and 4 40 Gbps QSFP ports. Okay, this is how it becomes your 56128 ports capability switches, in which now you can run the fiber channel, you can run the Ethernet based module as well. Okay, now taking the things further ahead, Nexus 2000, which will be the final series, okay, for today's class. Now, Nexus 2000, understand, only very small scenarios are there with respect to your Nexus 2000 series, guys. Very small. These are dumb devices, first of all. Abdul sir, Sushant, if present, required. These are your dumb devices. Neither Nexus 2000 series contain an operating system. There is no NXOS operating system which is present. Okay, and let me be straight, there is no ASIC which is being present inside this kind of device. No ASIC. Okay, there is no ASIC. Application specific integrated chip. That means it's a dumb device. ASIC basically makes a switch intelligent. It makes a switch think, how do I do, I need to work. So these Nexus 2000 are a dumb device, and these are also called as fabric extender, FEX. Now, understand, Abdul sir, if you are able to see that it is being written fabric extender, the name implies itself that I am just gonna increase the number of port. My only agenda is to increase the port. So if I have a bigger switch, that is being called as, first of all, let's suppose I have a Nexus. It can be getting connected by 9K also. It can get connected by 7K also. It can get connected by 5K also. for a Nexus 2K series device, these are called as your parent switch. Okay? Because all three devices are intelligent switches. And through to these parent switches, your Nexus 2000 device, basically your FEX will be getting connected. Okay, your FEX will be getting connected. Now, understand, I have FEX number 1, I have FEX number 2. And this is being connected to a parent switch. Either 5K or either 7K. Okay. Even if you want to connect these both, doesn't matter. The traffic, if you want to get connected from, let's suppose there is a device, device number A, there is a device, device number B, connected to each of the FEX. If device number A wants to send any kind of message to device number B, the traffic will always pass through the parent switch. Our FEX is not capable enough to send the traffic again to another FEX because there is no ASIC inside that. It's gonna pass the traffic to the parent switch, and from that particular parent switch, the traffic will be further move ahead to the device number B. Simple as that. Okay. There is no console port available on this. There is no management port available on Nexus 2 case. There is nothing. There is one port which you can see in certain models that is like this kind of. This port, in whenever we see in a television or something, this is basically called as a HDMI port. Okay. But Cisco says that this is not a HDMI port. They say that it's a utility port, which is being there sometimes required by the tech engineer in order to do the diagnostic of the device. That's all. Okay. So that they can diagnose that particular device. Because it will not give you anything. These are fabric extender. These are being used in order to expand the number of port, the number of slot. Okay. And of course, one more. You cannot connect the FEX with the catalyst switch. No, catalyst, it will not gonna work. FEX only gonna work with your Nexus switches. Okay. Make sure of that.
Sir, can we do port mirroring on these ports?
Sorry?
Can we do port mirroring on FEX ports?
Port mirroring, like if you can give me a certain example, I can...
Span type of thing.
Sorry?
Span, you know, we do port mirroring to replicate traffic.
I think the port mirroring capabilities are not available. Sir, these are basically none of the configuration part can be done on these devices.
Okay.
Okay. These will only increase. So, simple example I'll give you. Sir, like you have a 5K device, okay? And there are in total 72 ports you have on this particular device. And now you are connecting your 5K with a FEX module or a FEX device, your 2K device. This has 22 port. Sir, your total number of port will be getting increased. Interface.
So it's kind of cheaper than buying another box of Nexus.
Ah, of course. Okay. So it's
just like in a data center where you have a set of cabinets where all your core switches are, or distribution switches.
Yeah, what if your cabinet get ended after a while?
Yeah. And yeah, you've got another series of cabinets in a different part of the data center, yeah, where all the servers are. So rather than lay lots and lots of fiber UTP connections back to your central switch, you can place a FEX close to where the servers are and two uplink fibers back to your parent switch.
Correct. So yeah, yes. So there are certain uplinks which you will get. So FEX, this total chassis, if I just remove this complete segment of the drawing and if I bring over here this. So if this is your FEX, over here, there will be certain uplink ports, like 4 uplink ports are there or 6 uplink port. These are being used in order to get the connectivity to your parent switch, sir. Whereas the other port, either it can be Ethernet also, and somewhere there are certain models will give you the FC port as well. These particular port will just react as a fabric extender, which you can now get connected to the end host devices or the other servers. Simple as that. But when server one want to connect or send the traffic to any other server, that has to go through or via the parent switch. And that too, it's not like once you have connected the device with the parent switch through the uplink port. So this is your uplink port. Again, you will see that yellow color strip over here. Okay, you're going to see that yellow color strip on the uplink ports. But what I'm trying to tell is when you're connecting the uplink ports to the parent switch, it's not like directly it gonna understand or it gonna tell that, okay, I have been connected and now I can increase my number of ports. There is a concept of something called as, let me clear this board. There's a concept of something called as FEX ID. Okay, FEX identifier. Every FEX should be given a FEX ID. The range of the FEX ID is starting from 100 to 199. So let's say, for example, I'm saying that interface ETH 1/1 of the parent switch, I have connected to the FEX, for example. So in that particular switch, have you ever heard this command, switch port mode? Everyone, being into EI or the different segment, everyone, you have switch port mode. Now there are multiple options if you give a question mark over here. Sometimes you see switch port mode is access. Sometimes you see switch port mode is trunk. Sometimes you see switch port mode is fabric. Or in certain models, you will also see switch port mode FEX. You have to give the switch port mode FEX into that particular interface of the parent switch and give a no shut. Okay. And then you're going to give one more command called as, very important over here, FEX associate. And over here, you're going to give the FEX ID. And then you give the no shut. Once you do this, now that FEX ID will be given to all the interfaces. This particular ID, let's suppose 101, for example, this will be given to all the interfaces of that FEX, of that 2K device. Okay. In certain devices like 3850, In certain devices of Nexus, you will see switch port mode as FEX. In certain, you will see fabric also. Both means the same. That now you are connecting an external fabric. That is, you're nothing but 2K. Once you assign that FEX ID to that interface of the parent switch, and that interface somewhere is being connected to the uplink port of your FEX. So automatically after this configuration, all the normal ports will be assigned this new FEX ID. Okay. To one parent switch. If you have one parent switch, you can connect a maximum of 24 fabric extenders. 24. You cannot connect beyond that. And every particular FEX will be given a unique FEX ID. Okay, for one parent switch, you can have up to maximum of 24 FEX you can connect it out. Okay, now, in that also, there are different modules, like you have Nexus 2232P, then you have a model called as 2348PQ, basically, sorry, TQ for the Ethernet. Okay, so these are the different models you have, with 100 megabit Ethernet capabilities, with 10 gig of Ethernet capabilities. You have the 40 gig of uplink capabilities as well. Okay, 40 gig, obviously, uplink port as well are there. So these are all 40 gig ports which you're going to have, which will be getting connected furthermore to the parent switch. Now that parent switch can be a 5K, it can be a 7K, it can be a 9K, because all those support the 40 gig connectivity as well. Right? So this is what you have inside your Nexus 2K devices. Clear, everyone? Sir, yes. Tell me, sir.
Can it be possible that in the fax device, half the ports are uplink and half the ports are connected to downlink servers or downlink another device?
Sir, come back your question. Please come back.
I mean, can it be possible in the fax that half of the ports are uplink and connected to the parent switch and other half ports, other remaining ports are connected to another parent switch or a bunch of
no,
servers?
No. In the norm, the normal ports, you cannot connect to the parent switch. Okay, the normal Ethernet or the SFP ports which you're going to have, like it's a 48 port switch or it's a 28 port switch, that will be connected to the end host devices. Because see, in a data center, the number of end host devices and the servers are always more. So that is the reason that fabric extender is being placed, so that we don't have to completely utilize or waste the amount of port which is being given inside a parent switch.
Right.
Okay, and certain uplink switches, why uplink are less? Because these will be getting connected towards the parent switch. So only one connection is enough for me to define a FXID to all the interfaces and now connecting different end host devices to that particular FX.
Yeah, so even if some of the ports are connected to another switch or another or a bunch of servers, it will have the same FXID.
Yeah, it's going to have the FXID will differ. Okay. The FEX ID will be different. You can, I told you, you can connect a maximum of 24 FEX to a single device, right?
That's
so
right.
For these multiple FEX, the FEX ID will be different. But yeah, for one particular FEX, the FEX ID will be the same across all the modules, across all the ports, simple as
even that. If the same FEX connects to two different switches.
So if you are saying that I have a FEX 1
yeah.
that is being connected to two parent switches, okay,
yeah.
So in that, the concept is that the two parent switch P1 and P2 has to be into a VPC server. Otherwise,
okay.
You cannot. They have to act as a single logical unit. Then only this particular thing will work. So if that is the concept, then automatically at the end of the day, we are into one single result only, that I have one FEX device connected to one parent switch.
Oh, yeah, that's what I wanted to ask. Okay.
So that is possible with the VPC.
Right.
Cool. All good. Others, Emmanuel, all good. Rickward, Emmanuel, you came late today. I hope everything is fine at your end, sir.
Yeah, clear.
Great. Wonderful.
Yeah, all good. Sorry, I had meetings and stuff.
No
Sorry
problem, sir. No problem. Yeah. So you can visit the recordings. I'll upload it right now.
Yeah.
Okay, after the lecture. Yeah. Tomorrow we'll meet and tomorrow we'll start with our new concept as per VDC and taking the things further ahead. So I hope you all enjoyed the lecture. I will end with the, yeah.
After the recording is done, I have a question.
Yeah.
Maybe later you can tell us. In one of our data center configuration was, we had a bunch of 9300s and 9500s, not ACI, Nexus boxes.